Madagascar's more than 400 children victim of rape in 1 year. What account for this high rate of rape in our society? Get the answer in this edition of our 2 p.m. newscast. And in sports, join Ben Emmanuel as we take you into the world of football to evaluate the readiness of the Indomitable Lionesses of Cameroon ahead of their Saturday showdown game. Stay tuned for this and more in this edition. Good afternoon once again. My name is Abel Bela Samari. We open our news in health to tell you that Cameroon today, April the 7th, 2021, joined the international community to observe World Health Day under the theme Building a Fairer, Healthier World. It is observed annually to create awareness about health and well-being and draws the attention of people from all around the world to highlight important health issues. In line with this celebration, our reporter Finwe Crispin interviewed some Yaoundé city dwellers on how often they carry out medical cleanup or checkup and what impression they do have of the medical system in Cameroon. Take a listen to our report.
According to medical experts, persons in good shape should carry out a general medical checkup at least once a year. However, that is not the case with some Cameroonians.
As for me, I don't actually do checkup like monthly or once in 3 months like I'm supposed to do. I only go to the hospital when I feel like I am not fine.
I barely get sick. For example, in like 10 years, the last time I got sick was like a month ago. So that's what actually took me to the hospital because I believe I have a very strong immune system. That's for my general medical checkup. But then for my dental checkup, I try as much as possible to do it every 6 months. That's twice per year.
This city dweller blames this on the lack of medical equipment and infrastructures.
The plateau technique is not adequate. Even if the doctors are qualified, they don't have the necessary to prove what they are able to do. There is lack of infrastructures, there is lack of materials, and the cost is not for everybody. That is why many people find best to go abroad to find the better place for health.
Meanwhile, others decry the ill treatment they receive in some hospitals and health centers.
The health system here in Cameroon is so bad. Hospitals are very uptight. When you get there, their employees are very rude. The doctors are very rude. The nurses are very rude. They even discourage you from going to the hospitals. Most especially the public, the level of negligence there, it's just horrible.
Then the private sector now, they are doing their best. They're not as corrupt as the public ones, but they have been led to themselves. So they become exaggeratedly expensive.
They all round up by outlining some suggestions that could ameliorate the health sector in Cameroon.
If the government can actually try as much as they can to teach the hospital's employees some customer service on how to attend to patients, that would really be great.
So I think ethics need to enter. They need to use their ethics and be conscious and know that they are out to save lives.
For saving life is the principal duty of a medical doctor.
Finwe Crispin in that report. We stay in here to tell you that the theme of the 2021 edition of World Health Day is building a fairer, healthier world. For this to be achieved, people should have access to healthcare services and at an affordable price. Hence, the idea of universal health coverage comes in. This means that all people have access to the health services they need, according to Dr. Eba Beckling-Quele.
Universal health coverage is an initiative of the World Health Organization and the United Nations in general to implement the ease of access to health for all, that is all age groups and people with different financial statuses. So the aim is that everyone has an access to health despite the various limitations a person may have, which includes social standpoints, financial standpoints. The aim is to ensure that everyone has a significant access to health. That means a significant access to services of health.
On the importance of such idea in Cameroon, Dr. Eba Beckley says,
knowing that Cameroon is part of the third world, it's so important for such an idea to come up. because we have a lion's share of our population that can afford for their medical care. Medical care in global terms is expensive in general, but in our context even the more, because many people don't have financial stability. Such an idea will mean a lot to Cameroonians. If an organization comes to ease financial power as it concerns health, many Cameroonians will have the access, the required access to health.
All right, we saw Spurson says as of now, the level of progress of the announced universal health coverage is yet in progress.
In the year 2020, that is last year, there was a reunion between the state of Cameroon, the public health ministry in particular, and an organization called Santé Universelle Camerounais. There was a partnership between the two bodies to implement this universal health coverage idea. The private company actually came in with an idea to first of all have a database of all Cameroonians so that they can know how to implement this idea. And also the head of state together with the public health ministry had to sign this agreement with this private company.
Dr. Ebabe Klinkwele was speaking to our own Promise Akanto, who is joining me in the studio. Good afternoon to you, Promise.
Good afternoon, Abel.
Promise, you are the editor-in-chief here at Royal FM, and I want us to talk about the healthcare services in Cameroon that can be considered a thing for the rich, as only those who are finally financially viable seems to receive the treatment they deserve. The situation gets even more delicate in rural areas where the services and service providers are both rare. And in the following commentary, we look at the situation of healthcare in Cameroon, Promise.
Health is not just about physical well-being, but also about the mental and social aspects. A person is said to be healthy if he or she possesses all three. According to WHO, health is central to human happiness and well-being. Going by this, therefore, one would have expected to see governments do everything possible to provide good health infrastructure to their citizens. However, in Cameroon, this sector suffers both human and technical insufficiencies. From the medical personnel, some actually behave as though they were forced into the profession. Their nonchalance, arrogance, and lack of interest towards patients is beyond imagination. Their behavior can rather increase the pain of the patient, adding psychological pain to their existing physical pains. When the present Minister of Public Health came to office, he came up with the beautiful idea of paying unannounced visits to some government hospitals, and yes, he saw the torture people were going through in the hands of these health practitioners. Whatever happened to that initiative remains a mystery. And then, for those who even want to be present and polite, they lack the necessary equipment to provide adequate health care. Hospitals with unfurnished laboratories, and worse still, no power supply nor a standby generator in the case of blackout. The conditions of healthcare services in Cameroon leave nothing to write home about. Because even in the case where there are doctors and equipment, you will need to pass through the other door to be served. Because as they say in Cameroon, you should be someone behind someone.
Promise Akanti, I will stay in health to say the National Order of Medical Doctors and the National Council of Pharmacists of Cameroon have called on the government to introduce vaccination against the coronavirus to help protect vulnerable groups and reduce the spread of the disease. These health experts were speaking yesterday during an audience granted them by Prime Minister, Head of Government, Chief Dr. Joseph John Ngute. Let's now listen to Dr. Fran Dange Nana, President of the National Council of Pharmacists.
We need the government to protect the population. To protect this population, we need vaccine. Vaccination have side effects like all medicine. But we know that with vaccination of COVID-19, we contain the disease in our country. Ghana, Togo, Senegal. We need to join all the countries in the world to vaccinate.
In line with this call to introduce COVID-19 vaccine in Cameroon, our reporter Jementa spoke with Mr. Pechagwe George, a social critic, to get his perceptional view of this vaccine in Cameroon.
To me, I said no. I think there is no article in the medical constitution which says that they have to force somebody against his will to take a vaccine. One, would we like to know from those medical experts, counselors of the pharmacists, if they have also taken the vaccine as well? Has the vaccine been tested? and what is the result of the vaccine that they want to impose on us to use. I think that that is not a good way. This second wave of the coronavirus, something else should be done and not that.
And we away from health, we take this governmental news to say the Minister of Housing and Urban Development, Celestine Kechakutes, has paid a walking visit in the South region where she pledged her ministry technical and financial support to the construction of a Paul Biya Monument and Boulevard in Sang Malima. Minister Kechakutes has equally lauded the efforts of the mayor of Sang Malima to modernize the city. Here now is an excerpt of the Minister of Housing and Urban Development.
I'm very happy to see that the mayor of Sang Malima is what mayor should be when the decentralization is achieved in our country. He has decided to give the name of the head of state, pay recognition to the head of state on what he did to our country, what he's continuously doing, transform and modernize our city. And I'm happy to support him, make this place a wonderful one. I've also visited all the roads in Sang Malima, and I found that there are some roads going to the hospital, to the market, to school, which are not quite. When you have a dynamic mayor who wants to support the head of state, we are here to appreciate what he's doing and to transform as the head of state, transforming our country, Sang Malima, as a wonderful and modern city.
You are listening to Royal Afternoon Edition, the 2 p.m. newscast, coming to you from Royal 88.4 FM. And still to come, right ahead is the case of rape in Cameroon, where we have more than 400 children in a single year victim of rape.
It's a consequence of culture of poverty. Parents are not properly trained. Most often they have the tendency to deliver many children. We keep on going. So to break the chain is actually to give meaningful education to children.
The Minister of Social Affairs has raised concern on the high rate of insecurity and monitoring on children, which is gaining ground in the country. As Minister Pauline Wengele has revealed latest statistics carried out by her ministry, which shows that 1,074 children are going through severe punishment. 977 of them are being exploited to generate income for their families, and 477 are victims of rape, with 98 of them being male children. Involved speaking during the a plenary sitting at the National Assembly, the Minister of Social Affairs says there is an urgent need to secure the well-being of our children in Cameroon and to understand what accounts for these malpractices on our children. Our reporter, Jementa Court, talked with a sociologist and compile the following report for us.
Maltreated, flogged, no access to education, to food, to entertainment, and as if it was not enough, more than 4,000 children have been raped at the age of 5 years upward. And to find out what account for these malpractices, Dr. Peter Tata is a sociologist.
It's a consequence of culture of poverty. Parents are not properly trained. Most often they have the tendency to deliver many children. The same children will grow up, perpetuate the same culture, and will keep on going. So to break the chain is actually to give meaningful education to children.
When parents or guardians have more than two children, coupled with the fact that they are poor and idle, they will in one way or another make these children feel hell while they are still on earth.
You will realize that idleness always is a workshop of the devil. Parents who actually at home, who are unemployed, who pass most of the time at home with their own kids, may be tempted to do that. So to solve the problem, people must be occupied and doing meaningful jobs.
And to understand this upsurge of rape within households, the sociologist Dr. Tata Peter has this to say.
Coming to the idea of sexual abuse, nowadays it is the consequence of crowdedness, it's the consequence of promiscuity. Keep human beings together, even if they are related, confine them into where nudity is no more a problem, where no one hasn't got the right to intimacy. The consequence will be rape and things like that. Such an environment where there is no privacy, someone will be attempted to fall in love with somebody who is very close to him or her.
parents and guardians should not move away from the principle of valuing, protecting, caring for children, and for parents who don't have enough means should cut their coats according to their size. For there isn't a child who will tell you that he loves being maltreated, devalued, or raped. Abel
Jementa, I'm talking about the rape situation where over 400 children are victims of rape. Lambert Nursing is a legal mind. He looks at the legal provision that sanctions rape in Cameroon. He begins by defining rape in the context of the law.
A rape is being defined as having a sexual intercourse with one party without the consent of that party, void of misinterpretation and void of due influence. And rape is being classified as a felony if you are proven beyond reasonable doubt that you commit an offense known as a felony in our country. And then the punishment starts from a death sentence or a total loss of liberty or a maximum or a minimum of 10 years imprisonment. This is punishable by section 21 sub 1 sub E of our Cameroon Penal Code and would not show mercy on you, but will hammer on you as if nothing was happening.
Lambert Nelson went further to explain that parents who fail to protect their children from some of these social ills might be punished if found guilty in the law of court.
Now, it is obvious that the primordial responsibility of a family lies in the hands of the mother and the father, that is the parents. If you have your offsprings, then you have the responsibility to protect and take care of them, educate them and create awareness, telling them that if a strange person who does not belong to the family, even a family member, had to touch you intimately, and then you need to report to daddy or to mommy. But if they don't do this, then they have the responsibility. But it does not suffice that the rapists have the right to rape a child, either a boy or a girl, because the parents do not protect them. No. If you are being proven beyond reasonable doubt that you actually committed this offense, known as rape, classified as a felony, and then the law will not show any mercy to you. No. A felony is the highest capital offense in our country, and it's also rape is punishable like aggravated theft as well as murder. So the family member can be punished because they never protect their offsprings or their little ones, but it does not give the right to the rapist to carry out that terrible or devilish or Machiavellic act of rape.
We talk economic in this newscast. It is almost 4 months that Cameroon established temporary import ban to European and Asian countries due to the spread of the avian flu. It stopped the import of a day-old chicken and hatch egg, triggering a reduction in poultry production in Cameroon. But recently, on the 22nd of March 2021, Dr. Tiger, the Minister of Livestock, Fishery and Animal Husbandry, sent a letter to the Brazilian ambassador in Cameroon to communicate that Cameroon can now import poultry product from Brazil to make up for the shortage of the product. Dr. Tiger, in his letter, states to import is necessary an animal health certificate signed and approved by the Office of Poultry Product from Brazil. Moreover, Cameroon's veterinary services should be informed 24 hours before the poultry product arrives Cameroon. In the following Vox Pop conducted by Jementa, we tried to get the reaction of some Cameroonians per the decision to import frozen chicken.
Cameroon with the application of non-productive politics. It's also unfortunate that the Cameroon government prefers to invest a lot in import rather than encouraging or investing in projects in the country. Because Cameroonians have got a lot of talent. We can produce our chickens here without chemicals and all the like. But you realize the government investing millions to import chemicalized chickens, which is even harmful to our health.
The issue of sending frozen chickens from Brazil to Cameroon, to me, it should be out of place. It should be stopped. We have our own local way. We raise our own chickens in Cameroon. Why should we not put up industries? Why should we not put up factories? Why should we not put all these things to make sure that those we have enough chicken that Cameroonians can consume? Why must we rely on imported chicken from Brazil and other countries? The issue of even importing of frozen chickens out of Cameroon, to me, is not correct at all.
Allowing the importation of frozen chicken from Brazil to Cameroon is unacceptable. For the government to allow such a thing to happen, that means she is dragging Cameroon's economy downward. Cameroon is a livestock producing country on its own. We do not need chicken from any other country. Cameroon does the production. Cameroon exports chicken to other countries. So why should the government allow Brazil chicken to get into Cameroon? We don't even know how those people raise their livestock. We don't know the kind of product they use. It might be really harmful to the citizen.
Jementa equally spoke with an economist to find out the advantages or likewise the disadvantages of this move by the Minister of Livestock, Fishery and Animal Husbandry to import frozen chicken.
The advantage of imports is that imported chicken will go a long way to increase the supply of chicken in Cameroon and reduce the price. But I must confess to us that this government has failed, because in 2003, JICAM, the Groupement Interpatronnel de Cameroun, advised this government to stop the importations of these basic items, pork, chicken, beef, so as to boost local production. Now that they want to get back, they are doing some sort of a bafia dance. You want to allow Brazilians to get richer and then we get poorer. Just look at the balance of the payment deficit last year. It was 1,920 billion. Out of that 1,920 billion net deficit, 650 billion went only for rice, and we have large surfaces in Cameroon to plant rice. In fact, some of the economic managers have failed us. What the government ought to do is, government was supposed to train some would-be poultry farmers and then buy them the necessary incubators, let them be paying gradually so that we can sustain ourselves domestically rather than relying on imports. In fact, where are we going to in the 22nd century? See, importing chicken, then what will we do to cars and other manufactured goods? It is very, very sad.
We talk politics in this edition to see the president of the Central Regional Committee of the Social Democratic Front, SDF Party, has in a declaration decried the continual media and public space outing of party bigwigs who continue to drag each other names into much. Emmanuel Tonga says his declaration is a mediation that brings peace within the SDF. As Mapala Zita tell us more.
Mr. Tonga Emmanuel says he is leading a committee which stands for peace and unity of his party, the SDF, reason why calling on the two protagonists, Joshua Osi and Jean-Michel Nitu, on the dialogue table is very important.
Among our two honorables who were this last time a little bit under tension, so they must come back on the table and the party must go on. Many people think there was war, but there is no war. The center is playing as a mediator to bring back peace between these two persons.
The president of the Center Regional Bureau believes the personalities concerned gets his message.
They are listening. I think that the war was more mediatic in the television, radio and social media. There is no war. Now that all is back, I think the party and the two leaders will go in front, concentrate only on the only fight we have on our lives is to pull out this BR regime.
Well, worth noting that the SDF militants we talked to concerning the said declaration do not totally applaud the move. Kungaba Lionel expected the regional president to convene a meeting before taking such steps.
Decisions are not being taken by individuals. In as much as I appreciate part of the content of the communique, before a position for a region like this is being taken, what Mr. Tonga had to do was to convene all the electoral district presidents for Central Region to sit down and discuss and see what to deliberate.
For Mr. Wumeyi Bertrand, the regional bureau president is right in his call, though he is yet to understand why Jean-Michel Nitu is trying to do the job of the entire NEC by himself releasing a sack letter for Joshua Osi.
They just came to bring a certain reconciliatory attitude that people should calm down and wait till the election comes. There is no need fighting and telling the whole world that we are fighting. Nitu is just a regional president. So I don't know why he is taking this thing so personal. It is a national executive committee that has to decide on who to exclude from the party, not Nitu.
Definitely, the national executive committee will have the final say at the right time.
Mapala Zita, in that political story, we talk culture in this newscast to tell you that Cameroon is being showcased for its cultural diversity and bear the title Africa in Miniature. We will now discover or recover the symbolism of this title and how it is being perceived by Cameroonians with our reporter Susan Nayonge.
Africa in Miniature, a description coming from tourist literature, as there are a variety of factors that account for Cameroon being called as such. Mariam, who proudly believes her country merits this title, explains why.
We have cocoa, we have coffee, we have banana, we have rubber, all these plantations. We do exploitation, we go into timber, there is petrol, there is gold. We are blessed as a country.
Added to that, the country exhibits all major climates and vegetation of the continent, as well as landscape variety. Faith, on her part, showcases some hot spots in the country.
Cameroon is blessed with the Atlantic Ocean. We have touristic sites like the Waza Park, the Krop National Park. We have places like Kribi, which is a seaside resort with so many trees and so many attractive points, hotels. The people of Cameroon themselves are so amiable.
Besides this, French and English are the official languages spoken, a heritage of the country's colonial past, meaning two of the most popular languages in the world are being spoken. Speaking of which, Paul emphasizes on the diverse culture.
Cameroon is said to have over 300 ethnic groups, and when you pay attention to these ethnic groups, you'll find out that almost all the tribes or cultures of the different African countries or ethnic groups are represented in Cameroon, and for me that's an issue where we need to be proud of.
If one plans on a trip to Africa, he can just converge his route to Cameroon, as there is everything in one, something which Landry justifies without a doubt.
It is something that I can say obeys to a natural reality, because when we say Cameroon is Africa in miniature, we definitely refer to the diversity in terms of landscape, in terms of culture. Can a single person just show me any other country in Africa which has such a vast and inclusive cultural diversity?
One cannot turn a blind eye to the current challenges the country is facing, but it doesn't change the fact that Cameroon has one of the highest literacy rates on the continent.
Susan Nayonge with our cultural press, and join the rest of the English news desk at 6:30 p.m. for Cultural Vibes, where we welcome the Bangante people. We'll take you out of the country. And on this single note, for the first time, France has opened to the public key archive relating to the Rwanda in the 4 years up to 1996, 27 years from the start of the genocides of Tutsi and Moderate Hutus. They include the archive of former President François Mitterrand. A commission of historians were given private access in March, have already published their reports describing France's role during the killing as a momentary failure. It said the French authority remained blamed for the preparation of a genocide by the Hutus extremists, but it clears them of complicity in a slaughter that left over 800,000 people dead. We now welcome Ben Emmanuel for our 2 p.m. sport pitch. Hello, Ben Emmanuel. Good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon, Ebo Bella Samari.
We begin in football, where the Indomitable Lionesses of Cameroon have held their first training session in Turkey. The team will face Chile on the 10th and on the 13th of April.
You're correct. Time waits for no one, and indeed there is no time to be wasted. The 2016 African vice champions have begun gearing up for their two-legged intercontinental playoff tie against Chile. They had their first training session on Tuesday, a few hours after arriving in Turkey. Their second training gathering is scheduled for 6 p.m. today at the Complex Sportive MC in Antalya. A video session will take place an hour before. Only two players are left to complete the group of 25 players retained by head coach Alain Jonfa. A majority of the European-based players joined the rest of the squad yesterday from their respective clubs, amongst them Chot Diarra, Gabriel Abundiongene, and Raisa Fuji. The two-legged intercontinental playoff between Cameroon and Chile will take place on the 10th and 13th of April. The double header was initially scheduled for February this year, was later rescheduled to April due to COVID-19.
Emma, before you go, the quarterfinal of the first league matches of the UEFA Champions League continue tonight, Emmanuel.
Defending European champions Bayern of Munich face Paris Saint-Germain this evening in a remake of the 2020 Champions League final in Lisbon. But this time, Cameroon's keeper Eric Maxim Choupo-Moting will be starting for the German outfit. He's expected to lead the Bayern Munich attack, with star striker Robert Lewandowski and midfielder Marc Roca ruled out for the class. Serge Gnabry availability hasn't been confirmed by coach Hans Flick. Similarly, Alexandro Florenzi and Marcos Verratti will also miss out from PSG's squad after testing positive for COVID-19 last week. Brazil superstar Neymar, France forward Kylian Mbappe will lead the attack for the French Giants at the Allianz Arena. In the other game, Chelsea away to FC Porto. The Blues are coming from a devastating 5-2 defeat to West Bromwich Albion, and they hope to rectify their wrongs in today's clash. Both games begin at 8 p.m. simultaneously.
Thank you very much, Ben Emmanuel. We'll take the appointment tomorrow. As you unseat yourself, let's welcome Anne Priestley Kupiteku is here with us this afternoon for a summary of this newscast in the French language. Good afternoon to you, Anne.
Good afternoon, Ebel Bella Samari.
427 cas de viol sur les enfants ont été officiellement enregistrés au Cameroun en 2020. Les enfants sont de plus en plus victimes des sévices corporels. L'Assemblée nationale remet en cause à cet effet la protection et l'encadrement des mineurs au Cameroun. Pour un monde plus juste et en meilleure santé, c'est le thème de la Journée mondiale de la santé célébrée ce 7 avril 2021. Au Cameroun, l'occasion est donnée pour les populations et les autorités compétentes d'évaluer le niveau de prise en charge des patients. Toujours en santé, riposte contre la pandémie à COVID-19, le Cameroun reçoit ses premières doses de vaccin le 11 avril prochain. À l'international, Côte d'Ivoire, le nouveau gouvernement est connu depuis hier. À sa tête, le premier ministre Patrick Haché. La nouvelle équipe gouvernementale compte 37 ministres. En sport, champion Ligue européenne de football, la suite des matchs aller des quarts de finale a lieu ce soir.
Thank you very much. And it is with that summary in the French language that we wrap up this edition of our 2 p.m. newscast. More newscasts will be yours at 6 p.m. Royal Swai bilingual version between Jean-Jacques Foucault and Mapala Zita. The team keeping you company this afternoon is made up of Karopo Dastwintu, is our copyright clerk. Solomon Sana is our sound engineer. Link with my video editor on our Facebook page, Royal FM Cameroon. The news was produced by Susan Nayonge, with editorial coaching coming from Jean-Pascal Antiala. Coordination was done by on-station manager Bertrand Nwuna. General supervision was ensured by Reverend Pastor Emmanuel Nwebesai. For presentation, my name is Abel Bela Samari. Today is Wednesday, and it is plain fast to the economic, and Yannick Gelewi is here with me in the studio. Good afternoon to you, Yannick.
Good afternoon, Abel Bela Samari.
So what should we expect from the program Plain Fast to the Economic today?
Today we are going to talk about the unfavorable situation of the economic recovery in this context, and to know if we are more and more back to the wall because of the lack of planning and adaptation. Donc aujourd'hui sera question donc de revenir fondamentalement sur le contexte actuel et sur les capacités du Cameroun justement à relever la tendance dans la trajectoire de la relance économique nationale dans un contexte d'incertitude généralisée et surtout d'absence d'adaptation des politiques économiques nationales.
Listeners, don't move a muscle because up next is Plain Fast sur l'économique with Yannick Ngelewi. Stay blessed.